CG Market Watch, the latest cryptocurrency news that you can use. So we're going to be covering four topics today, right? And the first topic will be LINE opening a cryptocurrency exchange in Singapore. Now, it will be called BitBox and offer trading of more than 30 virtual currencies, but no fiat. Available in 15 languages except Japan and US, there will be a 0.1% trading fee. Now, I think LINE is basically one of the bigger messaging apps. I mean, personally, I've known LINE for, I think, about maybe seven. I've never used LINE directly, as in I'm more of a WhatsApp person, but I think, have you used LINE?
Yeah, I'm using LINE now.
Oh, wow, shit, okay. But I do know that LINE has merchandise, they have a large database in Japan and Taiwan, and I think even in Japan, Taiwan, and Korea, right? So right now, having said that, they have the means and the database to create this and pull this off. So, Andy, apparently you have some insights on how big LINE is. So how big is LINE?
Okay, so there's the first few things you need to understand about LINE. It's where is its global office, right, as of now. So it's currently in Spain, South Korea, Japan, US, Taiwan, Thailand, and Indonesia, right? And the thing about LINE is that it has actually been around since 2011, okay, due to an earthquake. The reason or the difference between LINE and other messaging app is that LINE actually kind of started because of an earthquake and tsunami that happened in Japan. So it was a charitable reason why LINE was created. But the interesting part was and is that LINE was created under a subsidiary group of a Korean company. So even though it's based in Japan, it actually was started out based off Koreans in that sense. So that was something that's really interesting, okay? And the company is called NHN. Now, it's also listed in NYSE, which is New York Stock Exchange, and the market cap is $10.08 billion as of today, right? It's a huge company. And when we talk about revenue alone, it generates about, okay, just talking about the sticker sales, okay? It generates about $395 million in just 3 months, in between April to June last year, all right? And so that's something really significant. So the main reason why I personally look at this particular news of LINE and comparing it with what other, you know, other social messaging app that are doing, be it Telegram or what's the other one?
Kick.
Yeah. So the main difference here is this: LINE has a series of games, right? They partner with Disney, Zoom Zoom, and different games. I used to play it just for fun. At the same time, they also have stickers, right? Their sticker sales are enormous, it's huge, right? And also, by the way, Thailand users use it too, right? Thailand people love LINE as well. They use it a lot as well. So it's really something that's quite interesting. Now imagine you have LINE tokens and you can be used on an exchange, and at the same time you can use it to buy stickers, you can use it to play games, and the whole ecosystem is just there, you know, to build on it.
Do you spend money on stickers, Mike?
I'm a boy, so not particularly, but I know people who do buy a lot of stickers.
The only stickers that I ever used to buy, well, basically 20 years ago, were real stickers that you could actually stick on a book. Apparently now these are virtual stickers that you can send to friends and even people you like. So this is extremely interesting to find out that actually there's so much revenue being generated from virtual items these days. So with that being said, which brings us to our next topic, which is South Korean government willing to regulate the market. Okay, so in terms of the crypto regulation guidelines in Korea, last year we were having a full-out ban on cryptocurrencies across the major countries that were helping us in terms of the overall market. So we had China, we had South Korea and Japan. Now you're seeing more positive regulations coming into play. So the Financial Services Commission, or the FSC, the main financial agency of South Korea, has requested the Korea Financial Intelligence Unit to oversee cryptocurrency transactions and user activity. This is, of course, looking into three major banks, all right, that will be providing banking services to crypto exchanges. Exchanges must conduct customer due diligence, or CDD, and enhanced due diligence. So this is somewhat nothing new to us as per se, but the fact that there's going to be a firmed up regulation happening right now, and of course with the major banks coming into play, I think this is definitely a positive. We are crying out for regulations to come into play, and of course countries that have these regulations will definitely be one of the first to be able to have this full swing. So Mike, so do you think that this is something that are you like happy about regulations, you know, you being, you know, kind of a rebel yourself, you know, not even knowing whether regulations are good or bad? What are your thoughts, man? Do you like people to know what you're doing when you're trading?
Instinctively, I would say no, I should be unregulated. My freedom is my own. I should be able to have my own privacy. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I've been regulated my whole life. The moment I open a bank account, I was regulated. I have my birth cert, they know where I am. And has it really affected me? Not so much. I mean, people always say that, oh, you're stealing my data, they know what I'm doing. But it's actually very convenient. You know, when I was searching for wedding rings, the moment I searched wedding rings, all my advertisements were rings.
Exactly.
So I could find everything I needed on the same page.
And as long as you have probably have a social media account, I mean, honestly, you don't give a shit about your privacy, just saying.
And I have nothing much to hide. See? All my transactions are very normal. I don't move a lot of money. Mm-hmm. I don't kill people, kidnap people, or do any human trafficking. Mm-hmm. So if they know that I bought my clothes from a cheap discount store, doesn't matter. Yeah. So end of the day, I'm okay with regulation. I think it makes it easier for us to get inside and feel safe. For all the things we want to say about how we should be our own bank, like what banking the unbanked, right?
Yep.
At the same time, if I'm the only one in charge of my own money, I might feel slightly unsafe. If I accidentally lose it or if I'm careless, there's no one that can help me get my stuff back. So with regulations in, I will go in even more.
That's good. I think regulations are something that I've always been pro about. Despite the fact that, yes, it does create multiple surveillance systems around the exchanges and also our bank accounts. But at the end of the day, I think it's definitely a positive. What about yourself, man, Andy?
I'm pro-regulations. I think I said it before. So.
Yeah.
You're not going to disagree.
Goody two shoes.
That being said, FBI working on 130 cryptocurrency-related investigations. So, Supervisory Special Agent Carl Armstrong says the FBI says the FBI has 130 open cases related to cryptocurrency. However, also mentioned that the cases are only a small sliver in the FBI's workload. Now, with this, right, I have a little bit on, to me, even whether you're FBI, or whatever, CIA or whatever, right, I would say that they are only concerned about the biggest ICOs or the biggest exchanges. Or the ones that have been tipped off that are moving the funds for the illegal activities or tax evasion. This is the only way that I would dedicate the FBI, CIA, or whatever kind of internal security related departments to go and work on it, because that is where you can actually crack down the biggest cases and also you can actually collect the most money. Right, I mean, look, it's just a very normal thing. This is something that has been going on even before this whole cryptocurrency space has been, developed.
What if it's just for the greater good, like altruistic reasons? Like, for example, they shut down Silk Road because it's doing illegal things like trafficking, prostitution, hitmen.
Fair.
They are going after individuals as well, not just corporations.
So I think it's good to have this kind of level of protection for people, right? You can't really entirely shut it down. Like, that was the biggest. But what makes you think that there aren't smaller portals that are still having that? I'm sure if you go into the dark net or the deep web, you're still going to be able to see all this kind of stuff happening. It's just that, it's just like back to what I'm saying. There's so much, it depends on how big the exchange has grown or how big that portal and what kind of revenue are we talking about for them to even look into it. Because it is a huge amount of dedication of resources to go and spend time to hunt down these people or to take down this organization.
Okay, so with blockchain technology, it's a distributed ledger. Mm-hmm. Actually, it's easier to see transactions.
Definitely. Yes?
So the only issue they have is privacy coins. If I'm unable to track where the transactions came from, then I have a problem finding these people. So what do you think about privacy coins and their role in this market now that it's getting more regulated?
If that were true, how did the guy from Silk Road get hacked? Oh, sorry. How did the guy from Silk Road get caught?
He used
because
Bitcoin.
He would, no, but then again, I'm sure that at that time they were also using Monero.
No, they registered Bitcoin transactions.
I'm sure that there's definitely a way, right? There's either through the IP address or through an email thread that they were able to break. At the end of the day, it's all about phishing for information. At some point, there will be a competitor that will want to rat you out, or even internally staff that may not be pleased with certain things, and that's how people get caught. Yeah, I'm just saying. It's just interesting how even with all this anonymity, people still get caught. So there's definitely a way that they've been doing it, and the FBI has mentioned that they are above the they are ahead of the curve, because in 2013 they were already doing it. So Also, in the next and final topic, we are going to be talking about IRS. Now, IRS is pretty straightforward. They are now going to start looking into undeclared taxes, right? They're ramping up investigations into unreported cryptocurrency gains. This is a very, very sensitive. We are not, of course, going to go into that, but I'm happy to say that there will be more tools for you to use, especially if you are a US citizen or you're in a regulated country that is into cryptocurrencies. So I think the main problem right now is I don't think people want to maybe they intentionally do not want to declare, but if they do, right, I think there are now tools that people can use to track their cryptocurrency trades and gains. So if the tools are already available and you decide to not use it, then of course you are definitely creating an offense. Okay. In terms of the IRS, right? Because they're stepping up, I guess it's always related to tax fraud and unreported taxable gains. At the end of the day, guys, if a country is having these guidelines already and you decide not to comply, definitely it's going to take longer for cryptocurrency adoption.
It's better a to make thing, some money and pay your dues than to make no money or go to jail.
You pay what's due to Caesar.
Or just get out of the country.
More difficult than to make it sound.
Okay, as much as a lot of people want to do that, I think it's always very, very challenging. Pay your taxes, guys. Okay? If you want to stay in this game, pay your taxes. Stop thinking like as if you are... Okay, if you want to not pay your taxes, right, there are ways to do it, but unfortunately, it's only for the privilege at this point in time. Okay? There's no way that in hell are you going to be able to get out of this kind of thing unless you're someone who has the connections. Right?
And even if you do, you shouldn't.
Yeah, and even if you did, you shouldn't. Okay, so that being said, what about capitalizing on this market situation? Okay, I think we are all looking at making sure that our viewers are still able to, you know, take advantage of this current capitulation that's happening. Now, capitulation means that a lot of forced selling has been happening. A lot of things are suppressed. We're talking about 60, 70%, even 80% down. Okay. There are trading strategies available, but however, we will review all of that in CG Premier. So if you have not subscribed to the channel, click subscribe. Also, if you have not caught our previous episode of CG Market Watch, don't forget to catch that. And at the same time, don't forget to like, comment, and click on the notification button. We'll see you in the next CG Market Watch.